Hey everybody, welcome to GFC Online on this historic Super Bowl weekend. I don't know if you can tell, but it's kind of a big deal here in Tampa, and we're so pumped for what's happening today. Actually, we have a very special service for you, Pastor Craig himself, and one and only two-time Super Bowl champion, head coach, Hall of Famer, Tony Dungy, are gonna be talking about what it takes to build the life of a champion. But before we jump into that, I wanna remind all you ladies out there, that beautiful conference is coming faster than you think it is. February 26th and 27th is right around the corner. So don't forget and don't miss out. Go to gfcbeautiful.com to sign up today. So here we go, it's time. Jump in your lazy boy, kick that thing back, grab your chips and your dip, and enjoy this message.
Come on, let's continue to sing his praises. Wild, and don't be afraid.
serve a faithful God, amen. God, we're thankful.
You are faithful to us, yeah.
Let's sing this together.
God of Abraham, you're the God of covenant, faithful promises. Time and time again, you have proven you'll do just what you said. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I remain steadfast. And let my heart learn when you speak a word, it will come to pass.
Great is your faithfulness to me. Come on, lift it up tonight. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting, same, I will praise your name. Yes, great is your faithfulness to me. Yes, you are.
You are faithful. You are faithful.
Ooh. God, we trust you in this moment. Come on, every voice, let's sing this together.
God from age to age, though the earth may pass away, your word remains the same. We believe your history can prove there's nothing you can't do. You're faithful and true. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart, but when you speak a word, it will come to pass. Great is your faithfulness to me
in every season.
Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting,
together tonight. I put my faith. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. No, I put my faith in Jesus, my your faithfulness.
I want to read a verse over you. Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10 says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." Oh, Jesus, you are faithful. Oh, God, help us to trust you, Lord, even when our circumstances say otherwise. When our situation is speaking loud and where fear is knocking at the door, help us to trust you. Oh, we trust you tonight. Oh, we trust you tonight. Oh, we trust you tonight. You are my strength. You are my anchor. You are my God. You are my strength. You are my anchor. You are my God. Come on, sing that with me. You are my strength. You are my anchor. You are my God. Come on, help me out. You are my strength. You are my strength. You are my anchor.
You are my
God. Oh, we trust you. We sing it out.
You are my strength. You are my anchor.
Prayer, nothing more, Jesus. We put our faith in you. You are our anchor. In Jesus' name, you are our anchor, God. Lord, we trust you. We give you all. You are amazing, God. We thank you. It's in Jesus' name we say, amen. You may be seated.
Grace Family Church, it's exciting to have our very own Tony Dungy with us today. And Tony, thanks for coming out. And as we talk about building a championship life, but I had to set that scene because not everybody, they don't really know football, but you know, again, to win a Super Bowl is very rare for coaches. And then of course, being inducted into the Hall of Fame as an NFL coach is another amazing thing. So we're excited. I'm still proud of that moment. You invited me to come on up and see that, and man, it's awesome.
Well, I've been blessed with a special career, and when you're young and little kid, you think about possibly making it to play in college, making it to the NFL, maybe scoring a touchdown, but you know, winning the Super Bowl, coaching a Super Bowl team, going into the Hall of Fame, those are things you can't even dream about. Just blessings from the Lord that there's no way to explain it.
Yeah, you know, that's really what we want to talk about today. It just seems like even though you've achieved so much, we're going to talk about building a championship life. And that doesn't mean a perfect life, but it's a championship life. But before we get into that, I know especially the guys in the room, they like hearing a funny locker room story. Anything you like, just something that would kind of...
Well, I guess my favorite locker room story is my first day. I was a rookie with the Steelers. I wasn't supposed to make the team. In fact, they wrote an article that I had gotten cut, the last cut. And Coach Noel, our coach, had told us, hey, I'm going to call you between 5 o'clock and 6 o'clock on Saturday night to let you know if you've been cut or not. So I waited in the hotel room the whole time. My phone didn't ring. I started thinking, I wonder if I'm on the team. So I went to Three Rivers Stadium. I was afraid to go in the front door.
You didn't even know if you were on the team.
I didn't know if I was on the team. I assumed I wasn't because everybody said there's no way you can make it. So I didn't go in the front door. I went around the back entrance, and I snuck in, and I looked around, and my stuff was still in my locker, and my nameplate was still on there. And I said, I think I'm on the team.
Oh, that is great. That is a great story. You know, I know for me, I do a lot of messages and always tie in sports because I think there's a lot we can learn, you know, from your football life and your football journey. You've made a lot of spiritual applications, I know, in your life. And that's really what we talk about today. Some of the things that really are those transferable principles that work in our everyday life. And there's a scripture I like to start out with that I know you're very familiar with, and it's in Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, and it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. Tony, living out your faith in today's culture is really challenging to do. I mean, how have you done that on a football team and some of the things that you have done to lean on your faith but still live in this culture?
Yeah, I was so fortunate and so blessed. I was kind of raised that way by my parents. But you get into sports, and especially as you climb the ladder and get into big-time sports, the tendency is, well, I can't live that way. I've got to be like everybody else. And I was fortunate that I went to the Steelers, and we had so many guys on the team that said and taught us, no, you've got to put your faith first, and it is important, and being a Christian is acceptable. And I just learned that there, that no matter what happens in life, I'm going to do it God's way, I'm going to honor him, and it's going to be okay. And so many things in my life didn't make sense. I mean, the story for me just to get to the Steelers and be a quarterback my whole life and never play defense in my life and then play on the greatest defense in history.
Wait a minute, never play defense. You were drafted as a quarterback.
I was not drafted.
You weren't even drafted.
I was a quarterback, okay. And that's all I had ever done in my life. And the NFL draft comes around, and I didn't get picked. And so I had a chance to go to Canada and continue to play quarterback or try to play in the NFL and change positions. And the Steelers signed me and moved me to defensive back. And I'm on this all-time great defense, have never played defense in my life.
Wow.
And I'm trying to learn and making mistakes and just playing terrible. But one thing after another, the Lord just kind of orchestrated it.
Yep.
And all of a sudden, I'm on the team. In my second year, we win the Super Bowl. I lead the team in interceptions. And, you know, you couldn't write the story that way. But God allowed it to work.
Acknowledge him in all of your ways. I mean, even though the plan, you know, I'm offense, but now they got me on defense. But just continuing to trust God no matter what the circumstances are. You know, something that came up, too, in your coaching career, and has been mentioned many times, it seems like a lot of coaches got to use four-letter words to motivate people. But that's another way where you said, you know what, I'm going to follow God's way. I mean, you know, that in that culture to make that kind of stand, I mean.
Yeah, I again, played for Chuck Noll. He did not treat us like that. He taught us everything was positive. And that's the way I grew up. He hired me on his coaching staff when I was 25 years old. I learned and watched him for 8 years. And so I said, hey, I'm going to be a Christian coach. That's who I am. That's what I said.
You said, okay.
That's who I am. I'm a Christian. I learned from the best. He coached with respect. He coached us this way. That's the way I'm going to do it. And I ended up climbing the ladder. But when I got to that, I was Denny Green's number one assistant. Everybody said he's going to be a head coach. I'd go on these interviews and people would say, he's not tough enough. He's not mean enough. He's not demonstrative enough. I don't want him. Year after year after year, I wouldn't get the jobs. And it comes back to that Proverbs 3, 5, and 6.
Yeah.
Trust the Lord. Do it his way. Don't worry about what the world says. Our chaplain with the Vikings just kept telling me, Don't worry about it. God's got a place for you. God's got a place for you. Come to Tampa. I wasn't even the first choice. They wanted Jimmy Johnson, and he went to back to Miami. Then they wanted Steve Spurrier, but he decided to stay at University of Florida. So the dominoes just fell, so I ended up getting the job, but I wasn't gonna change who I am. And I came in, I remember the first meeting, I told the guys, I'm not gonna use any kind of profanity, I'm not gonna curse at you, I'm not gonna mistreat you, but I don't think you need that to play well. Yeah. And some of the guys, it took them by surprise, but after they were around that for a while, I think they appreciated it.
I think what I've heard the most, I heard Warren Sapp one time actually on a radio talk about the respect that you commanded because of the way you lived your life among the players. And again, living God's way, not compromising. I think Romans 12, 2 says, do not be conformed to this world. And I think sometimes we're tempted. Yeah, I've got to do it a different way to get promoted. But you said, I'm going to trust God. This is who I am. I'm going to follow God's way. And yet God was able to promote you.
People told me that, hey, I'm trying to help you. If you want to advance in your career, you better do this, you better change. You better not, you can't be as close to the players. You can't be friendly with the players. You can't have this type of approach if you want to succeed. And I would say, thanks, I appreciate that. And then I would just go back and say, I'm not going to change. I'm not going to compromise my values just to, if that's what it takes to get ahead, I'm not going to do it.
You know, I think that's a great lesson for anybody, whether you're a young person trying to make it on a team or make it in life or a businessman. You know, the world always has a way that seems like there's a shortcut. But, man, if we can just acknowledge God in all our ways.
I'll tell you another funny story about that pressure and trying to fit in. Back in the old days when I was playing, it used to be customary on the road trips. When you got on the plane, they would give you two beers as a way to hydrate. And I remember my first road trip, I had never had a drink in my life.
Yeah.
And they passed out, I got this plastic bag with two beers, and I was thinking, gosh, if I don't drink these, they'll think I'm a punk. But if I do, how am I gonna drive my car when I get off this plane? And this was going through my mind, and I was like, God, and looking around at everybody, I wanted to fit in. And Donnie Schell, who ended up being my roommate, strong Christian guy, he got his two beers and he gave them to someone else. And when I saw that, I said, you know what? Man, that's what I can do.
That's awesome.
And but it was just, I needed that role model who said, I don't have to be like everybody else. I don't have to do what everybody else does. I do what I know is best.
You know, it's amazing. I think it is the little things.
Oh, I was that close.
Yeah. The little things that we can start, we compromise the little things. Before you know it, down the road, you're compromising, which brings up my next point that you're really big on when it talks about building a championship life. You talk a lot about personal accountability and being accountable to other people. You know, we're a big believer in community and groups. You had a great relationship with Donnie Schell. Tell us a little bit how that was a big part of your spiritual life.
Coach Knoll, and this is how God works. Coach Knoll put me in room with him in the dorm because I didn't know anything about defense. He was a defensive player. He said, you get with Donnie Schell, you watch what he does, you do what he does, you'll be okay. Well, Donnie was the strongest, most on-fire Christian athlete I've ever been around. So I'm unpacking my stuff in the dorm that first day, and he's saying, hey, what are you reading? I'm like, I'm reading the playbook. I'm trying to figure out how I'm going to be on the team. No, no, what are you reading? What do you mean, what am I reading? What are you reading in the Bible?
Oh, man.
And I was like, well, I really haven't read the Bible in a while, and I certainly didn't read it today. And he said, oh, man, you got to read your Bible every day, and I'd watch him at night. He'd read, he'd show me something. Hey, next morning he'd be up reading. Pretty soon I got into the routine. And then he's telling me, hey, you got to come to chapel. We got chapel every night. We got Bible study. You got to be there. And he helped me grow. But it was that role model that I needed that made a difference in my changed who I was at 21 years old.
So that's a great foundation for building a championship life. We all need a Donnie Schell in our life. And we pray that for all of us at Grace Family Church, man. We find that person, that tribe, those people that they really motivate us to go the right way. You know, the Bible says bad company ruins good morals. Well, then good company must motivate us to do the right thing. And again, that's such a key part. Tony, there's another thing about that I want to share or at least ask you about. People think, you know, they look at your life and you've had championships, you know, with a team, you're a Hall of Fame coach, but yet, man, all of us have adversity. You know, we all go through adversity. So When you think about overcoming adversity, what would you say, you know, from your personal life, you would say to us about where, how do people not get stuck in the adversity but overcome?
You know, Jesus said that in this world you'll have problems, you'll have trials, you'll have tribulations, but follow me, take heart, because I have overcome the world. And I think as Christians sometimes we kind of feel like that, if I follow Christ, everything's going to be fine, everything's going to be good. And that's not the case. It wasn't the case for me. And I think that's one thing people don't understand about athletes. Yeah, you look at them and they're on a pedestal and boy, I'd love to have their life, but athletes have the same kind of problems, same kind of issues that everybody else has. Yeah. I remember our Super Bowl year, 2006, we're playing a game against Jacksonville early in the year. Reggie Wayne has a great game, catches a touchdown pass, gets us a big win. We're in celebrating. And our PR director comes up to me and says, I need to talk to you. We've got to let Reggie know. I just got a phone call. His brother just died in a car accident in New Orleans. And I'm thinking, man, we're in here celebrating. This guy's caught the winning touchdown pass. Just the, you know, everybody's fired up. Everybody's excited. And now somebody's got to tell him that his brother just got killed. And in those moments, you better have something to depend on, not the world, not the touchdown passes, not everything's fine, everybody's kind of looking up to you, but what do you really have to rely on? And to me, that's where God is.
Yeah, that's a perspective. In fact, it reminds me of James, and you know this verse very well, James chapter 1. Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. I'm like, is something wrong with this guy? And then he goes on, for you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. I know we hear it all the time. Adversity is good for you, but it's hard when you're in the middle of it. But we got to have a perspective that God's with me. I'm going to get through this. And there's all kinds of adversity that come our way. And I think the part that maybe you can address that people don't see, you know, we are in a spiritual battle, right? I mean, we don't wrestle. We're wrestling not against flesh and blood. That's a part of adversity too as Christians.
It really is. And understanding that you do have to battle. It's not going to be easy. Winning a Super Bowl isn't easy. You have to fight through things. And that is, to me, that's what sports teaches you about life. But that's what life should teach us about spiritual life and about God, that it's not going to be smooth and easy. Yeah. And we have to battle. We have to do our part. We have to hang in there and fight. But when we do, that's when God's going to grow us.
Yeah, I'm reminded too, you know, that it says that we should not be unaware of the devil's schemes. Well, before you prepare for a football game, you're looking at the video of the other team. And the Bible, I mean, to me, I think Christians, sometimes we can be, ignorance is a strong word, but man, we need to wake up that we are in a battle, that we have an enemy out there that wants to trip us up, wants to destroy us, our families, and we got to stay in the Word, don't we?
We do. And just like when you're coaching, every team has strengths, every team has weak spots. Yeah. Well, you're foolish to attack the other team's strengths. Yeah, I'm going to look for their weak spots. That's where I'm going to go. And that's what Satan's going to try to do with us. So we've got to understand that, and we've got to be ready for those attacks and those battles. We've got to know what our own weak spots are, scout ourselves, and say, hey, you know what? If I got a problem here, or if I'm a little weak here, I better get some help and be strong and pray about that, because that's where Satan's going to attack
us. And he always loves attacking people that are alone, right? I mean, when you don't have accountability or a group of people in your life, but when you have that, people can encourage you in that too. There's another verse, and it's whole on this part of relationship. In fact, it's the name of your wife's running group, Iron Sharpeners. Proverbs 27:17 says this: as iron sharpens iron, so does one friend sharpen another. I mean, again, I'm reemphasizing a point, but how critical is that for people when they're going through adversity that you don't even fight it alone? You should have others in your corner.
It is so important, and that's why football coaches, you always assign roommates. You know, it's not that the team can't afford single rooms.
I didn't know that. So they actually have two guys in the room for accountability.
Road trips and in training camp that you know, hey, if a guy's struggling, to have somebody there with him to talk through those things, that's important. And I've always had that in my life. I've been blessed the last 14, 15 years here with some guys who are in an accountability group with me. James Brown is one of my best friends in broadcasting. We talk constantly and help sharpen each other. Yeah. But I think God wants us to do that. He doesn't want us to try to live this out by ourselves, to try to figure everything out by yourself.
Yeah. So here we are, Tony Dungy, Hall of Fame championship coach who says, hey, I still need people in my life. I still need accountability. I mean, no one's exempt. You know, I think that that's that whole thing about pride sometimes. I don't need other people. You know, pride comes before the fall. And in fact, I want to ask about that for a minute. And it's kind of a funny one, but a hard one, dealing with divas. I mean, whether it's a family member or someone in your business, or what would you say to maybe those who have, they're trying to figure out, how do I motivate this person, but you got someone who's really, really talented, but they're just not good in the locker room? I mean, give some advice to some people out there.
Well, I think as a coach, your job is to try to get the best out of everybody and try to blend everybody's talents together. Some guys, it's harder than it is with others. Some guys are just naturally team-oriented. They are willing to sacrifice and do everything they can for the group. Other guys are individuals, but you got to find a way to just work into that guy's heart and see if the light bulb will go on. Yeah. And so for me, it was always talking about team concepts and winning and trying to get everybody to buy into winning a Super Bowl. But it's hard. And you ask yourself, how can I get through to this person? Yeah.
So you've had some of those hard conversations, obviously, and just kind of saying those things, man, this is not about you. It's about the team. That could be a family member. It could be someone in your business. But if you don't have the hard conversation, then you shouldn't expect any different result.
You've got to try to figure out a way to crack that hard exterior. And it might take time. It might take a lot of prayer. But that's important. That's how you build a good team.
You know, there's a couple of verses, actually. To me, Tony, you and your wife have lived this out. But there's a danger to success. But here's what it says. But those who exalt themselves will be humbled. But those who humble themselves will be exalted. You've seen a lot of people get really successful, and unfortunately, some of those people changed. How do we avoid that? There's some business owners out here. I mean, they're killing it, and all of a sudden, how can you keep us grounded? You know, I mean, I know how my wife keeps me grounded, but you know, it's dangerous when you're successful.
I think the best thing to keep you grounded is really understanding the Bible and understanding what God says. Many times we'll get to the point where we think, I'm doing this, I've really done a good job, I've worked hard. And sure, you have to work hard to succeed. But if you ever think that you have done it without the Lord, that's when you better look out. That's when you're going to be in trouble. And so for me, it's always been, how can I take this success that I have and point people to the Lord? How can I demonstrate? So being humble isn't necessarily saying, oh, I'm not very good, I didn't do anything, I didn't accomplish anything. But to me, being humble is, what success I have, how can I use that to direct people to Christ?
That's good. And I've heard you say many times, it's been God. God's the one that got me here. He's the one that opened a door for me. And really realizing God's the one that brings favor to us. And you know, it's funny. I know there's probably a lot of people at Grace Family on all of our campuses. There's probably some people, Tony, whether it's a man or a woman, or it could even be a teenager, and they look at the first half of their life and they're going, man, it's 35 to nothing. I'm losing. I've made some poor choices in my life. I want to build a championship life. Is it too late? I just know there's a lot of hope. But what would you say to someone that's maybe in a place of failing, and what would you say to them right now?
I would say, hey, you can't give up. And that's one of the things that sports teaches us. I was telling you the story before of our great comeback. I'm in Indianapolis. We're playing the Bucks. It's my birthday. We're down 35-14 with 4 minutes to go.
21 points down
with 4 minutes to go against the best defense in football. Looks like we have no chance. I was about to give up and tell our offensive coordinator, we're going to substitute and take Peyton Manning and the rest of our group out. He said, nah, I wouldn't do that if I were you. As long as there's time on the clock, we ought to try.
Wow.
4 minutes later, the score is tied.
Wow.
And we win in overtime. But it comes from, and that's what you learn in sports, that you never give up. We're playing a game to get to the Super Bowl, playing the New England Patriots. They're our arch rivals. we're losing 21-3, and you know, it's just everything looks bad. We ended up winning the game, and so many Colts fans tell me now, oh, that was my favorite game. That was the best game. Yeah. I remember, I was here when I watched it, and I can remember every minute. That was my favorite game. Yeah. And I'll say to them, you do realize we were only ahead for 1 minute in that whole game. Wow. We were behind for 59 minutes. Wow. But we didn't give up. We scored with a minute to go to take the lead, and we won the game. And it was awesome. But for 59 minutes, it was a struggle. Yeah. And if you give up, if you throw in the towel, you never know what God can do if you don't play that last minute.
Man, that is a good word. So there's 4 minutes left. You're down 21 points, man. You don't give up. It reminds me of a verse in Proverbs. I think it says, the righteous man falls down 7 times. And he calls him a righteous man, but he gets back up every time. Man, I'm telling you, if you just didn't hear anything today, get back up. You know, God is full of grace and mercy and forgiveness. Sometimes we have consequences for choices, but his grace and mercy is there. Like the prodigal son, he got up and he goes, man, I'm not where I'm supposed to be. And he got up and he went home. Halfway home, what a great picture, Tony. It shows his father running out to meet him, full of compassion, not full of, I'm going to get you. Why did you leave me? Man, I hope you hear that there's 4 minutes left. Get up. God has a plan for your life. It's not over yet. And I pray that you really heard that today.
Yeah. And there's probably one other thing I would really like to share with our audience, because I know we've got football fans watching this. And it's something that I learned. My mother taught it to me, but I really, again, learned with the Steelers. And that was my mom's favorite verse in the Bible was Matthew 16:26. What would it profit a man to gain the whole world but forfeit his soul? And I got to the Steelers, and Coach Knoll told us, don't make football your whole life. Yes, wow. We want to win, but if you make football everything in life, and that's all you do, you're going to be disappointed, because football is going to come to an end. And I was in the National Football League 31 years, and I saw that happen. I saw guys rise to the highest level you could rise in football. Super Bowl rings, big contracts, notoriety, Hall of Fame. And at the end of the day, they were miserable because they did forfeit their soul trying to make it. Wow. And that is a lesson that I learned. And I always wanted to, when I became a coach, I wanted to get that across to my players. Don't put so much into the game and neglect your spiritual life, because the spiritual life is what's going to matter in the end. We're talking Super Bowl today, this week. Who won the Super Bowl 5 years ago? Who won it 10 years ago?
No one really remembers.
No one cares at this point. Who's going to win it next year? That's all they care about.
Right.
Those guys, if they're out there putting everything they have into winning a Super Bowl, 5 years from now, they're going to say, what did I do all this for? But what is my personal life? What is my relationship with God like? Where is that at? Because that's what's going to last.
Wow. Well, I tell you, I was going to say, what are your closing thoughts? I think you just gave it to us. I really know there's probably people out there. You've built a great life, even a great career, maybe even a great family. And all those are good things. It's not that they're bad. But if your foundation isn't Jesus, you're actually probably feeling a little empty. Like, what is my purpose? And if that's you, maybe... You know, you've gone after all these things, but your soul isn't filled. It's filled with things that haven't really brought joy and fulfillment in your life. We love to pray for you. I think there's probably people watching the Super Bowl party right now. They're going, I came for a Super Bowl party, and all of a sudden I'm hearing this message that's speaking to me. Well, we know this, that the Bible says wherever two or three are gathered, that he's there. And I believe he's right in the middle of some of these Super Bowl parties and right in some of our campuses. Right now, they're going to be watching this, and we would love to pray with you. If you need to give Jesus Christ your life and you've never done that, let's come on all of our campuses. Let's bow our heads and pray. And Tony, would you lead us in a prayer just for those people that for the first time, or maybe it's a recommitment to give your life to Christ? I love Tony to lead us. And you can just pray this prayer maybe silently across all our campuses, or maybe that Super Bowl party. And that would be really cool, right? At a Super Bowl party, I committed my life to Christ. That would be cool.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Tony.
Amen. Lord, we thank you that you have created Super Bowls, and you created excitement and ways to get us together and enjoy each other. But you created life to honor you. And Lord, for that person who maybe hasn't honored you, but knows that they have something inside saying, I need to do that. We know it's very easy. You say, if I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord, and I believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And I believe that, Lord, and I confess that. And I thank you for your promises that you will bring me into your kingdom and give me eternal life if I confess that today. And I thank you and praise you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And if you prayed that, you're the winner today, no matter which team wins.
That's how you build a championship life. That's the foundation. God bless you, Grace Family Church, and go Bucks.
Yes, sir.
Thanks so much for joining us today. Also, we have an exclusive pregame moment today with Tony Dungy himself, so stay tuned for that. Look for it on our YouTube channel. I want to remind you to stay connected, gfcflorida.com. See you next week.